Good evening and welcome to Horizonte. President Obama launches a campaign to fix the nation's immigration system, and Democrats in Congress renew the fight for the DREAM Act. We'll hear from two recent ASU graduates and an advocate for this legislation that would provide children brought to the U.S. illegally a path to citizenship. That's coming up next on Horizonte.
Funding for Horizonte is made possible by contributions by the Friends of Eight, members of your Arizona PBS station.
Thank you for joining us. I'm Richard Rellis, internet for Jose Cardenas. Last week, Senate Democrats reintroduced the DREAM Act, legislation that would grant legal status to undocumented immigrants brought to the U.S. illegally if they attend college or serve in the military. This legislation passed the House last year but died amid Senate Republican filibusters. Tonight, we want to bring you the perspective of two recent ASU graduates and what it means to them if the DREAM Act passes in Congress. With me tonight are recent ASU graduates Angelica Hernandez and Evelin Rodriguez Villareal. Thank you both for joining us. I guess first, congratulations is in order for making it through your time at ASU.
Thank you.
When did you, Evelin, when did you discover that you might be in this situation at the end of your college career?
I discovered it when I was about in second grade.
And already in second grade, you knew you were going to go to college?
Yeah. My teacher went to ASU, and I believe it was one of her classes that she invited me to go and sit, you know, and experience what college life is all about.
But what made you know that at the end of this you might not have the college career that graduates have?
That same year, my dad got deported to Mexico after working at a restaurant. So I knew that.
But you, all the ramifications were there? You knew that even if you got a degree that you wouldn't be able to use it?
Yeah, I knew.
And Angelica, what about you? When did you discover that you would be in this boat at the end of your graduation ceremony?
Well, I have an older sister who's a year older than me, so she kind of went through the process before me of, you know, applying to ASU and then realizing that she couldn't, you know, apply for financial aid and different scholarships. So, you know, in high school and, you know, probably, you know, coming out of middle school, I knew that, you know, okay, I was going to college because that was always, you know, a family value, but at the same time, I knew that I was undocumented and I wasn't going to be able to use my degree.
You talk about being a family value. Typically, it seems like it takes immigrant families two or three generations to produce a college graduate. What do you think it was that instilled that value in you at such a young age? I mean, you really did defy the odds to come here and suddenly graduate college. What do you think instilled that in you?
I think it has a lot to do with our parents. I know my mom and my dad, you know, first of all, my mom only has like a sixth grade education. So just seeing every day how she works hard and how she has to do all this work to, you know, just get by at the end of the day, for me and my sister, it was kind of certain that we needed to go to college because she would always say, you know, it's all about education. You know, you have to go to school. I would have gone to school if I could have, but I had to work to help my family. So, you know, it's always been something that is talked about at home, and you always know that no matter what, you know, you should go to college.
And for you, was it your teacher or was it your family?
It was both. Unlike her parents, my parents actually did graduate from high school, except that for my mom, she always had to work. Even like at age 16, she had to leave her hometown and move to the city. So with me, it was always, you know, you have to get an education to actually be able to provide for yourself, but eventually a family that you're going to have.
How did your family come here? How did you come here as a kid?
Well, I was 5 years old, and they just told me, you know, you're going to go to the United States, and I was like, okay.
You didn't put up much of a fight?
I didn't, because my aunt used to live in Chicago, and then she would always bring me stuff, and I always wanted to go to Disneyland also. So when they said, let's go to the United States, I was like, okay, we're going on vacation.
Did you ever get the Disneyland trip?
Eventually, yeah.
No, but I mean, at five, did you know what you were doing? I mean, do you remember crossing or how you crossed?
I don't remember crossing. most of what I do remember is that back in Mexico, I was in preschool. So I was already accustomed to going to school. But when we arrived here, I couldn't enroll in school until I was 6. So I had to wait a whole year. And I don't remember any of it. I just know that once I got in school, it was really hard. I remember going home and crying that I didn't understand the teacher or my peers.
And that's one of the things that I guess Arizona is not supposed to be great at educating students in general, and not supposed to be great at educating English language learning students in general. But when did you start picking up English and excelling in school?
Well, I picked it up that year.
Wow.
I'm very grateful for my mother. You know, she didn't know any English at all, but yet she would sit down and actually do the homeworks with me. And it was a constant communication with the teacher of, you know, like, how can I help you? Like, are you understanding at least a little bit of it? And ESL also helped.
What about you? How did you get here? How did your family cross?
Well, we crossed through the desert. You know, it was kind of the same thing. For me, my mom was just like, okay, we're going to go to the U.S. because your dad is there, and we're just going to go and, you know, see him, because we haven't seen him for, 2 years or so. So I do have some memories of crossing, and, you know, it was pretty scary, and I remember walking long hours and having to sleep in the desert and stuff.
You did it not the driving in a van way, no. But the walking.
We were walking for a lot of hours. So I do remember that. And once we got here, I started the fourth grade. I was 9. So like Evelin, you know, in Mexico, you start school when you're very young. And I actually started when I was 3 years old. So I was in preschool for 3 years. And then once I came here, you know, I started fourth grade, and it was really difficult because of, you know, not knowing English. And like Evelin, you know, you just try, you know that it's something that you have to learn. So you do your best to try to learn it. And I still remember having, you know, doing what I used to do was listen to people and see what it sounded like. Because, I mean, you don't know what they're saying, but I would listen to someone say something and then see what outcome they would get. And then I would go try it and repeat, try to sound it as close as you know, as I could to what they had said to get the same outcome.
But you felt that same sort of feeling of being lost in...
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did television help? Did...
Yes.
Yeah.
Smurfs or Powderpuff Girls or whatever it was at the time?
I remember watching Barney and Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood.
Sesame Street.
Oh, good. Yeah. Public broadcasting.
Yeah. Yes, actually.
Well, I'm going to keep you here for a couple more minutes before we talk about politics. But I notice, if I'm looking at the monitor just off the screen, we're not obscuring your face, and we're not digitizing your voice to disguise it. You're here speaking with your real name and your real face, and this is who you are, and admitting that you cross the border illegally. What is giving you the idea that this is a good thing to do, or that's giving you the strength to be here and risk, you know, deportation?
I think people need to put a face to the issue that's going on. It's time that people start generalizing or saying, oh, well, it can't be my neighbor, or it can't be, you know, the person at the store. Like, they need to start putting a face to the situation.
And a face that I guess is not what we typically, I mean, typically if we see an illegal immigrant on television, they don't look like an ASU graduate, I guess.
They probably would think somebody like my dad, who is a landscape worker, you know, like jeans and, you know, bright orange shirt, you know, that's probably what they think of, but no, it could be anybody.
What about you? I mean, did you have friends at ASU or through high school who are surprised now to find out that you're saying you crossed mm-hmm. the border illegally?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think it's always been a scary, you know, thing for anyone here undocumented to come out and say, you know, I'm undocumented and I'm here. So I think that, you know, like Evelin said, it's really important for people to know that we're here and for people to realize that there's thousands of us that are graduating every year, and that it's something that has to be dealt with, and it's something that, you know, it's going to keep growing unless, you know, people know and start supporting, you know, our education and being able to pass the Dream Act. Then, you know, I think that's what it's going to take, just people coming out and stepping up and saying, I'm here, I'm undocumented, I want to, you know, become legalized, and I want to be able to contribute.
What kept you going? I mean, you had a business degree, supply side management, correct?
Supply chain management.
Supply chain management. See, I don't even know what, I don't even know enough about business to know what you majored in. And you were top in your class in mechanical engineering. Difficult career choices. I mean, you didn't major in, you know, journalism or something that's easier. What is it that kept you driven to push yourself despite knowing that there's probably a brick wall in front of you at the end of this?
My family. I have two younger siblings, and they're both girls. And at the end of the day, also myself, because I knew that if I accomplished this, that I would be able to, you know, go to these politicians or go to these people that don't know what's going on really and educate them and be like, no, like, I'm here. Pay attention.
Well, speaking of politics, as we mentioned earlier, President Obama launched a public campaign for immigration reform and made his renewed push in El Paso, Texas. Also, Homeland Security Secretary Janet Napolitano, the former governor of Arizona, also commented on the president's call for reform on PBS NewsHour. We'll hear from an advocate for the DREAM Act in a moment, but first, here's what they said last week.
In embracing America, you can become American. That is what makes this country great. That enriches all of us.
An estimated 11 million undocumented immigrants now live in the U.S., and the president said it made sense to offer them a path to citizenship, in addition to securing the borders. And he challenged Republicans to join him.
We have gone above and beyond what was requested by the very Republicans who said they supported broader reform as long as we got serious about enforcement. All the stuff they asked for, we've done. But even though we've answered these concerns, I've got to say, I suspect there's still going to be some who are trying to move the goalposts on us one more time.
I think the president has done a number of things during the course of his presidency, but specifically over the last 60 days to say immigration remains a problem for our country. It's a law enforcement issue. We have to do enforcement in a smart and effective way. We believe the steps we have taken demonstrate that we are doing that. We have to have a secure border. We believe the massive amounts of resources we've deployed there demonstrate that. We also, however, need to look at the economic ramifications of immigration and look at how we handle, for example, visas for agricultural workers, visas for high-tech workers. We need to deal with the so-called Dreamers, the Dream Act students. That's going to require Congress.
That's you guys she was talking about. And with me tonight is Carmen Cornejo with Cadena, a DREAM Act advocacy group. Thanks for joining us. Carmen, this legislation has been sort of languishing in Congress for a decade or so.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think the chances are of it passing this time around?
Well, it's important, the reintroduction of the DREAM Act right now, because it gives us an opportunity to keep fighting for it. And
but
also,
do you think, I mean, given the makeup of Congress now, do you think it has a shot of going through?
Realistically speaking, no. But it's important, the introduction of the DREAM Act, because we have a legislation to claim. For example, if a student is in danger to be deported, and we're talking about people with good moral character and a lot of professional academic accomplishments, then we want to refer to this legislation to stop the possibility of deportation. There's a DREAM Act there. And we're hoping that this legislation eventually is going to pass. So please hold on.
That eventually the laws might be
exactly
changed.
Exactly.
You also probably monitor a lot of talk shows or internet sites and,
yes,
and blogs. What is the climate? Has it softened at all in the last couple years about this issue?
I think it's mixed. I think our mission is to educate as many people as possible about the benefits of passing this legislation, but also educate the congressional delegations across the country so they can vote positive eventually for this. But we think that we're gaining advocates. We see even housewives that they want to integrate to the advocacy of the DREAM Act because they see the unjust situation for the undocumented students and also the potential that these students can bring to the country. And we have two wonderful examples here with Evelin and Angelica.
So you're saying this works,
this
strategy
works. And education works. And it works for our communities to have more people educated, especially in critical areas as mechanical engineering and supply management. And one very important fact is that the students benefited by the scholarships here in Arizona, 52% are going to STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, and math areas that are critical for the development of the country.
Well, and let's talk about those scholarships. Politics played a role during, I imagine, during your college career. When did the Prop 300 pass? You probably know this much more than I do.
In 2006.
Okay, so that required you to pay out of state tuition. So you paid out of state tuition your entire college career?
Yes, I did. It passed in the fall before I graduated. So I started out at ASU with having to pay out of state tuition, the $20,000.
So you're the first. You were part of the first class.
The first class to be able to graduate, having to pay out of state tuition.
And you took a little. How long did you take to go through college? When did this start affecting you?
This started affecting me about maybe my sophomore year. I was still lucky enough to pay in-state tuition, and at that point, my parents, you know, worked extra hours to be able to pay the in-state tuition. But once Prop 300 passed, it was kind of like, oh no, what do we do now?
Was that like a major blow to you psychologically to think, I was able to pay a few thousand, but now out of state? I mean, did you think about, I have to go to community college, or I have to do something but go to ASU?
Well, my parents from the beginning knew that I didn't want to go to community college, that I wanted to be, you know, the first one to graduate from a university. So they, you know, they sat me down and they were like, you know, like, don't think about community college yet, you know, like, let us figure out something out. Let us, you know, sell the car, sell, you know, my mom was going to start selling Tupperware. She's like, well, you know, we're going to do something to make this work.
How, was there a gap between when you needed to pay out of state tuition and when these scholarships that we'll talk about came in? Did they have to sell Tupperware? Did they have to do things like sell a car to get you through?
Fortunately not. But, you know, we sat down and we talked about options. Even, you know, my parents going, you know, even if you just take one class, as long as you just stay in the system, you know, we'll make it happen.
Did it slow down then your progress? Were you taking a fewer
I did,
okay.
Yeah.
And then, again, you're a senior, you're thinking about how to get there, the scholarships. It must have been daunting to see that price tag.
Yeah, it definitely was. Especially because I graduated as a salutatorian. So, you know, applying to ASU early, I was able to get a merit-based scholarship for my grades that would cover all of my tuition. So after Proposition 300 passed, those scholarships were taken away. We no longer were eligible for any state-funded or you know, the merit-based scholarships that we would be eligible for our academic achievements. So, you know, after that, I was kind of like, okay, what am I going to do now?
Was part of the reason you did so well in high school was thinking, I'm going to get scholarships at the end of this, that this is, there's a rainbow here, there's a light at the end of the tunnel here?
Yeah, I mean, I think as students who have parents who work in jobs that, you know, they're making a little bit of money, there's no way that they would be able to fund our education, especially out-of-state tuition, just from their jobs. So I think that a lot of us, you know, one of the drivers in us doing so well in school and us being so involved in community service or any other clubs and organizations on campus in high school is because we need that funding, because we know that if we are involved and we show that we're getting good grades, we're top students, we're helping in the community, we go and volunteer at a veteran's home or something like that, we really want to, and we have that passion for education.
I guess the intent of that Prop 300 was to get illegal immigrant students out of universities. Did it work, if that was the intent?
Out of community colleges and out of the universities. And we have seen the numbers dwindle dramatically.
Do we know where their students went? Did they leave the country?
Some of them are taking one class at a time. But definitely this is discouraging a lot of students and young people into pursuing higher education. Some people are even decided to go out of state to other states that are friendly to students to achieve education. And this is very ironic, but these two ladies can get jobs anywhere in the world with the U.S. Yeah. with this situation.
Did you see friends of yours, people who might have shared this secret with you at ASU, drop out? Or did you share this with many people at ASU? I know the Cadena and the Dream Act Coalition started, but were there a lot of people you told about this as you were going through?
Well, we formed a close-knit, group of friends, and some of them, like she said, did go out of state. Some of them did drop out.
Yeah.
And in reality, you're never going to know the numbers because some people never came out and said, I am undocumented.
And as you were going through high school and thinking about scholarships, did you also ever think about if there's any way I can regularize my status? Did you look into how to do that?
Yeah, I think, once you realize that you're going to be having to overcome all these hurdles to be able to get your education, you try to find anything that, could make it easier to get there. And that was definitely something, looking into what I could do to become, to get legalized. But since, I was brought here illegally, there's currently no pathway to legalization for students in that situation. So even if I wanted to apply for something, even if I wanted to go through the system, there is no process for me right now.
Right. I think because you entered illegally, there's a 10-year bar that you would have to be back in Mexico after a year or so, and then you'd come back. Did you look into it, or did it seem like something that was a possibility?
I looked into it. And, there is no process. And then you always heard the people, well, just get married and, you'll be set. And it's like, no. First of all, I don't want to get married just, for that. And second of all, even if I did get married, it's still...
There's not a process.
Mm-hmm. What do you plan to do? I mean, you have a degree. She said, it's true, you could probably work anywhere in the world. What are your plans? How long are you going to stick it out waiting for the Dream Act to pass before you have a plan B?
Well, for me, I think, I want to be able to pursue the same avenue that I have been at for the past, of years after high school, which is higher education. I can't get a job, okay. I'll try to go to grad school and be able to get more educated. Get my master's, get my PhD, which is something that I can still do. I can find private funding to be able to get through a master's program or something like that. But I mean, it's definitely something that I hope, by us being here and by us sharing our story and what we're going through, that I hope that it creates that urgency for legislators to realize that there's a real need for the Dream Act.
And if you go through a master's program or a PhD program, again, we're talking about out-of-state tuition, correct?
Yes.
What is your plan with supply chain?
Well, ideally, once you graduate, you want to go out in the field and actually start working before you continue your master's or your PhD. So right now I'm still kind of like in this gray area of I don't know what to do yet.
Have you thought about Spain, Canada, Mexico? Have you really thought about going to another country, or do you want to stay?
I haven't thought about it because I really want to stay here and fight, for the other classes that are going to graduate and are going to be stuck in the same situation as me.
You heard Carmen say she doesn't think it's going to pass this year. What do you think in your heart? Do you think it has a chance this year?
I know it doesn't. But again, we have to, every little effort that we do mm-hmm. counts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We need to keep fighting.
Yourself, what do you handicap the chances are of the DREAM Act passing? And do you think your speaking out might move the needle a bit?
You know, I think over the years, you know, during high school, I started getting involved in Cadena, actually. And I've seen that there's a lot more support. And I know the day will come when it will pass. And we need to stick around so that we can be able to educate more people and be able to create more supporters, because you know, if you see it on the news, if you see it on newspapers and all of that stuff, if you just talk about it and educate people about it, you're going to get more people that are going to support it. So I think that's what's going to make it happen.
I thank you all three for joining us tonight, and that is all of it for Horizonte tonight. I'm Richard Rellis. I'll get that out eventually. Have a good evening for all of us here at Channel 8.